No sense of sound. No smell of air. Breathless. I drifted among faceless shapes, without a clear distinction of form. Blinded. Until someone or something made me soar. Higher and higher still I went. That is all I can remember.
I don't believe you. Now sit down. I'm sorry, but you can't leave until you tell me. Where are you from, and what is it that you seek in the colonies?
I was raised in the West. I'm visiting the colonies in search of my roots.
Do you or do you not swear allegiance to the Lord Protector as a servant of his protectorate?
Yes, I am a servant of the Protectorate. Aren't you?
The Protectorate does not own us. The colonies may be inside her sphere of influence, but its people are not. You, on the other hand, were wearing their uniform. The bright blue fabric, the golden stitching, it tells me that you are part of the crew on one of their ships, probably a merchant vessel. The embroidery even says that you were the captain of that ship. Impressive. But what happened to your ship, Captain?
I'm sorry, I'm getting really tired. I'd like to take some rest. We can talk later.
Are you trying to buy time? That's not going to work.
First, tell me who you are.
I am the Rani, and you can address me as such. Now, is this journal yours?
Where did you get that? Who gave that to you?
It says Devon Rensburg inside. Is that you?
All right. I'm Devon Rensburg. And yes, that is mine.
I already know it's yours. I'll give it back to you, once you've enlightened me on its contents. Now read it for me, and remember, I expect the truth. Again, where are you from, and what is it that you seek in the colonies?
Fine. I'll give you the long version. It's not like I have any choice. I come from the West, born here in the colonies, but raised in the capital of the Protectorate homeland, a city that never felt like home. I never connected with its people. I was always the outsider. So I decided to leave that place, in search of my roots. I had heard about someone in the harbor recruiting men for a merchant ship sailing to the east. It was a standard trading mission along the Indigo route. I had never worked on a ship before, but enlisting in the merchant navy was the only way for me to acquire passage across the sea. So that's what I did. The recruiter, Aaron Ludlow was his name, took me in a rowing boat out of the harbor. And there she was, his lordship's vessel, Herald.
God, Ludlow, have you read this?
No, sir, I haven't.
Your people seem to be causing a lot of unrest in the colonies lately.
My people, sir?
Well, you know.
I don't know, sir.
The Indigo farmers, they claim the trade does not benefit them enough. They accuse the Lord Protector of abuse of power and demand fairer wages. The local regent has yet to respond, but I fear he will cave in to the pressure.
Is that why we have the politician on board?
Yes. Senator Morton is the regent's brother-in-law, and he's going to help him with the complex politics of this affair. He's also accompanying the regent's daughter safely back to the colonies. Remember to treat both of them with respect.
Sir.
Is there anything else you brought from shore?
Well, apart from the new recruit, a letter, sir, addressed to Senator Morton.
Well, what are you waiting for? Give it to me.
But, sir, it's not your...
My ship, my rules, Ludlow. You know this. Besides, I don't think Mr. Morton has anything to hide from me. He better not.
May I remind you, he is a Protectorate official, sir.
And so am I. You there. What do you think, boy? Should I open the letter or not?
Me? Sorry, sir. I didn't...
This is Devon, sir. The new recruit that I picked up in the harbor says he wants to work as a sailor aboard the Herald.
Mr. Rensburg, sir. Devon Rensburg. Delighted to make your acquaintance, Captain.
Captain Cornelius Hendricks. Nice to have you aboard the Herald, Rensburg. I assume you understand that there are rules here. Officer Ludlow will give you the lowdown on them during your tour of the ship.
Sir, I have other...
But first, Ludlow, I'd like you to find Senator Morton and send him here. I need to talk to him about this letter of his. Be quick about it. I'll send Rensburg off to you in a moment.
Yes, sir. Be sure to see me on deck, Devon.
So then, Rensburg... I take it you must be returning home to your family?
I'm a Protectorate citizen. My home is in the capital. But it's time that I see my country of birth, and hopefully, find out who the people were that gave me up for adoption. I know my father is a Protectorian, and my mother is originally from the colonies. It won't be easy to find them. That's why I'm writing everything that might help me with my search down in my journal.
Yes. Yes, I see. Well, You should look at my globe then, Rendsburg. As you see, the colonies are very big. You should write it in your journal. Well, off you go to your tour of the ship. Have a nice evening.
There was a globe in the room. The ornate rooster on top stretched his wings out over the world, as if protecting it. The captain's cabin was one of the few places on the ship with a heater. The crew didn't have such luxuries at all. The captain's newspaper lay open on his desk. Colony unrest, it said. The rest was too difficult to read from a distance. The paper stand on the captain's desk was filled with letters stamped with a protectorate seal. Cornelis Hendricks seemed to be an important man. Looking at the display cabinet, I wondered what his collection of exotic and antique weapons said about the captain's character.
Oh, well, I would assume he's reading your letter right now, Mr. Morton.
I sincerely hope you're joking.
No, on the contrary, sir. At sea, the captain makes his own rules. As far as I can tell, our captain is king on the Herald, sir. The crew, his loyal subjects.
Officer, there are several reasons why the people got rid of the king back in the day. This is precisely the sort of thing that led us to abolish the monarchy. I'm going to have a word with Captain Hendricks now. Please carry on.
Not one, but two large ornate compasses stood on the poop deck near the ship's wheel. Protectorate design seems to favor perfect symmetry. I was quite often tempted to take over the wheel and sail us on a random course towards adventure, but that wouldn't have been a smart move. So many lines and ropes that were going literally everywhere. I still can't comprehend how most sailors I met on the Herald knew the function and name of all of them.
That, Devon, was Senator Lewis Morton. Did you see the look on his face when I told him the captain opened his letter? Pure agony.
It would be fun if we could see what's happening inside the captain's quarters right now.
It would be, wouldn't it? People have a hard time adjusting to life outside the capital. On the open sea, the rules tend to change, but customs don't change with them. Mr. Morton is a prime example of that, and you will probably experience the same. The trick, though, is to accept change. It's something that people like Morton will never understand. But you might.
If there's anything I want, then it's change. To finally be able to do things differently for a while. I'm done with the old rules.
There's a reason I picked you from the lot. I rarely choose anybody who is unfit for a life at sea. Now for your tour. Welcome aboard His Lordship's vessel, Herald. A Cromwellian class protectorate clipper launched in 1851. As one of the fastest sailing ships in the mercantile fleet, she can reach a top speed of 18 knots. During her short life, she has already set multiple records sailing to the colonies and back along the famous Indigo route.
Really? How fast is 18 knots exactly?
A knot is the equivalent of 1 nautical mile per hour. Since a nautical mile is a little over a regular mile, it means the Herald can sail at approximately 21 miles per hour. And before you start, we still use imperial measurement at sea. Metric has yet to catch on in the Navy. Proof that even sailors have a hard time adjusting to certain changes. Now let's move on to the deckhouse.
A brass sign forbade anyone but passengers and officers to enter the deckhouse. It appeared to have been placed quite recently.
The Cromwellian class ship type is named after one of the Protectorate's founding fathers, Oliver Cromwell. These ships are merchant clippers, built with trade in mind. Making money is their sole purpose. The Herald is an indigo clipper, which means she mainly takes shipments of indigo powder to the Protectorate homeland. With this powder, we make the paint that coats the hulls of our ships, and the dye that gives the fabric of our clothes its bright blue hue. You've lived in the capital, Devon. Never noticed the rooftops of its buildings or the clothes of its people? Everything has been coloured blue there. The colour blue touches on much that the Protectorate holds dear. And indigo is made from a plant that produces the only known blue dye that withstands heavy wear. Until anybody finds a cheaper substitute, the indigo trade remains an invaluable part of our economy.
I never really thought about blue dye in that way. Sounds like a huge undertaking.
It is, but that's not without reason. After all, the Protectorate is built upon free market principles that foster progress through supply and demand. Its people get paid an equal share for the work they do, and with this money they are free to do with as they wish. I am not fond of life on shore, but even I can see that the system works. For most people at least. Now, onto the bow of the ship. Thank you.
All day long, you could hear the chickens cackle. Though the meat was reserved for friends of the captain, their eggs were a special treat for the crew at weekends.
We are standing on the weather deck right now, where you will work every day ensuring the safe passage to the colonies. You will be tasked with tying the knots, reefing the sails, and swabbing the decks. There will be no talking to first-class passengers, no idling around the ship at night, no begging, no fighting, no stealing, and most of all, don't get caught trespassing. Now that sounds like a lot for you to worry about, right?
I'll manage.
That's what I thought. Don't worry, it'll get tedious soon enough. Keep in mind that the dining saloon in the deckhouse is only for first-class passengers and officers during this trip. This was a special request by Senator Morton, so please steer clear from the saloon if you want to keep out of trouble. Anyone without a blue coat should just use the service stairs through this door here. Now, is there anything in particular you would like to know?
Why is the deckhouse reserved for passengers and officers?
Customs, Devon. It is meant to make you work hard so one day you earn yourself a blue coat too. Were it not for the presence of Mr. Morton, though, this rule would not be so strongly enforced by the captain. Now just go through this door, past the officers' cabins, and you'll find the service stairs on your right-hand side. Down those stairs you'll find the crew's quarters and your bed. That concludes the tour, Devon. I hope you enjoyed it. I will have to stay out here. I'm on watch tonight. The boatswain will wake you up tomorrow morning to prepare you for the day. Good night.
The capstan is a rotating device that is used to apply force to ropes, cables, and hawsers. But I have heard that some captains tie disobedient sailors to it, with their arms and legs spread across the levers. The Herald's figurehead had impressed me when I first saw it, but standing on deck, I sometimes forgot that it was even there.
Want to and take this thing back.
But Ian, it's a gift.
I don't need it. I don't need any of this.
Get out.
I didn't mean to.
Get out.
I know you are out there, and even though Mother taught me to address you properly, I know your language is different from ours. Please, hear my prayer. Listen to my heart.
A risque pin-up poster hung tucked between two opposing walls. It tried to sell the colonies on some sort of exotic fantasy. I have to admit that its delusions were once mine. I wondered if everything was all right inside.
Go away, Ian. If you want to apologize for the compass, then now is not the right time.
Are you all right, sir? I heard something break. Oh, by the way, I'm Devon Rensburg, sir.
Rupert Brunswick, first officer and navigator. Nice to meet you, Rensburg. Welcome aboard. I'm sorry for my tone. I didn't mean to be rude. I do appreciate your concern.
It's all right, sir. Nice to meet you too.
Well, I'm fine now. But let me give you some expert advice, dear boy. Be careful whom you trust on board. Some people might not be worthy of your friendship. Keeping to yourself will save you from disappointment. Now, off to bed. It's very late.
I was quite surprised to find a flag in the drawer. I'm sure it would not have pleased the Lord Protector to see our symbol of power tucked away in a nightstand. Boxes, big and small, were everywhere on the Herald. I wondered what was inside the one on the table, but I didn't dare to open it. The playing cards, strewn everywhere, seemed to indicate that the sailors liked to play games. I preferred to write in my journal, rather than occupying myself with such silly things. On the table stood an open bottle of wine, and there it remained for the rest of the voyage. Maybe I should have taken it to the galley to be used as vinegar. The apples reminded me of home. Looking out of the window of my small room, I used to dream about this journey while staring at the fruit trees in the garden. Most books I found in the crew quarters were racy accounts of comical adventures, so it was quite surprising to me that my crewmate Arthur was reading works by Chaucer. All crew carried luggage, some of them more than others, but nobody carried as much junk as Hjalmar Olsen. Why? I had no idea. It was getting late. I had to go to bed.
All hands on deck! The sun is out and breakfast is served on the gun deck. You too, boy. Ian!
Oh, I'm not well, sir. It's probably the food from last night. I don't really feel like eating anything right now.
Oh, really?
Well, I don't trust Andra's bangers and mash either, but you won't make me believe that they made you sick. That would be way too convenient for you.
I'm not lying, Caleb. My stomach tells me that something's wrong.
That's Mr. Haywood to you, boy. And I know exactly what you're thinking. You heard that Ludlow was sick this morning, so you're trying to blame it on the food. Nice try, boy. Now get up and start running.
No, I won't. You can't force me. I'm going on strike.
Ha! Don't make me laugh, kid. You wouldn't last a day.
Is Ludlow really sick? What does he have? He looked fine yesterday.
He looked kind of pale when he went to bed last night. Probably seasick or something. You the new guy. Rensburg, ain't it? I'm Haywood, boatswain on this here ship. You should report to Officer Brunswick at the helm. Needs his boy to do an errand for him. But since this wretch won't get out of bed, maybe you ought to do it. You up for that?
No problem, Heywood. I'll get right to it.
Just follow the instructions Officer Brunswick gives you. Now, off to the helm with you.
I'm seasick again. Yeah.
As strapping as sailors come, even they can't lift most cargo without the use of a dolly winch.
I don't need them, Captain. Might I suggest we raise the studding sails to maximize our speed?
I still want to see them, Rupert. Where is that boy of yours? Get him to fetch the maps.
I haven't seen him this morning. It's possible that he's still...
Ah, good morning, Rensburg. Nice to see you up and running. Rupert, have you made the acquaintance of Devon Rensburg yet? He's our new sailor.
Yes, yes. We already met last night. Good morning, Rensburg.
Good. Now, Rensburg, have you by any chance seen a boy named Ian this morning?
He is ill, Captain. Not feeling well at all, he said. So I'm taking his place for today.
When is that boy going to step up his game, Rupert? He's your student. Discipline him, or I will.
I heard that more of the crew are sick today. It could very well be that they're all sick for the same reason.
Nonsense. The boy is weak. He needs to be dealt with swiftly, lest he never become a man.
I agree that Ian might be a bit weak, frail even, but a man with his gentleness is something the world might benefit from one day.
Some say you're soft, officer, but I appreciate your honesty. There is no denying that it has got you quite far in life.
Please, just leave the boy for a day. I'm sure Rensburg will do fine in his stead. Right, Rensburg?
I'll do what I'm told to do. So is there anything I can help with?
The captain would like to see my maps. Since Ian's not here, I'd like you to fetch them for me. My map of the European coast should be somewhere in my desk. I'll tell you a secret. I keep a spare key to my cabin in the pitcher in the officer's hallway.
The pitcher contained a spare key to Officer Brunswick's cabin. A broken compass lay shattered inside Brunswick's desk. It was a shame to see such a delicate object destroyed. I got the sudden urge to write something obscene in one of Brunswick's books. I realized that this was an incredibly stupid idea. I found Brunswick's maps of the European coast inside the drawer of his desk. There were books about navigation, geography, mathematics, and poetry. None of them looked very interesting to me. Looking through the Merchant Navy's handbook, I discovered that officers are usually allowed to carry guns, but other members of the crew are not. One of the paintings on Brunswick's wall was a depiction of the Battle of Scheveningen, the final battle of the Anglo-Dutch War. A painting of the night sky was hanging on the wall. The use of colors was striking. One of the paintings depicted three white boys playing with a ball in a sunlit square. On the top shelf stood a portrait of a stern-looking man. I later learned it was Brunswick's mother. I found Brunswick's maps of the European coast.
What took you so long? Were you lost? My cabin isn't that big, you know.
I'm sorry, sir. I'll ensure that I'm faster next time.
Ian would have done such a simple task in mere seconds.
Give me the maps, Ransburg. Well, that's convenient. According to these calculations, raising the studding sails might double our speed. Ransburg, find Boatswain Haywood and ask him where he keeps his studding sails. He's probably somewhere near his workshop.
Look, Uncle! Water as far as the eye can see. Imagine how big the world must be.
Yes, dear.
You again. So how does your new job suit you, huh?
I'm doing fine. It's not the best work, but it's not that hard either.
Well, of course they wouldn't trust you with hard work like mine. Now would they? So, what do you want?
I'm here to collect a set of sails called studding sails. They say you keep them here somewhere.
Ah, so you're the official errand boy now, huh? Well, it just so happens I need something done.
What exactly are you talking about?
Someone's been sneaking around my workbench. The key to the weapons cache was in a different drawer than usual. So, I checked the cache and discovered I am missing a Colt 44. If the captain finds out, we'll all be held responsible. So we need to find that thing before he gets wind of it.
Why do I have to do this? Why aren't you going after the culprit yourself?
You think I got nothing better to do? Let me tell you something, Rensburg. You'll need allies on this ship. This is a good opportunity to prove to me what you're worth. I'm too busy right now, so I really need someone else to fix this. The crew will owe you one if you can return that gun safely to me. Now, go and find out who stole that thing, will you? And be careful what you ask people. We don't want to cause a panic now, do we?
I wondered what him reading an amorous tale of the chaste loves of Peter the Long said about Caleb's love life.
Rensburg, what are you doing up here? Shouldn't you be getting those sills?
It's a bit embarrassing, sir. But I wanted to tell you that I'm afraid of pirates. I've read the stories of what they do to sailors like us. How do the crew protect themselves from such scoundrels?
You've been scaring yourself with children's literature, Rensburg. Piracy has been dead for years. Though I have to be honest, I met a pirate once. Not very scary, just a foolish robber who thought he could earn easy money by killing people. Such savagery. But you should hurry up now and get those studding sails from the boatswain.
There was one particular corner on the main deck where the captain couldn't see you from the poop or front deck. Littered with boxes, barrels, and sacks, it provided cover for those in a bit of a lazy mood.